Hi, I'm Dave Burkhardt, and I'm here to welcome you to O'Fallon TV's newest show. O'Fallon Matters was created to inform you about the issues that directly impact our lives and our community. Our stories will focus upon community programs, citizen profiles, education, athletics, and other amazing tales from O'Fallon. Stay with us for O'Fallon Matters. Hard times have fallen upon numerous members of our community, but one program aims to assist those who could use a helping hand with vital home systems that need replacement.
Is there no room in your budget for important home repairs or replacements? The City of O'Fallon's Home Improvement Loan Program can help you repair or replace vital components in your home.
We offer five-year forgivable $5,000 loans for home repairs. The five-year forgivable means that if you stay in your home for 5 years, you never have to repay the loan. It will disappear. If you decide to sell your home within the 5 years of receiving the grant, you'll have to repay the $5,000 upon sale, but at zero interest. Eligible repairs include roof replacement, window replacement, electrical, plumbing, driveway replacements, any type of code violation, basically, because we will come in and we'll do a code inspection on your home. The purpose of the program is to make your home healthy and safe to live in. So we can do heating and cooling unit replacements, which definitely help out on utility bills. As far as aesthetically pleasing projects, as far as, you know, flooring replacement, cabinetry replacement, countertop replacement, those kind of things we don't do. We basically want to focus on making sure your home is healthy and safe.
Applying for O'Fallon's Home Improvement Loan Program has never been easier. All you have to do is download an application at www.ofallon.mo.us, or you can come up to City Hall and pick one up.
I was amazed, actually, how easy the process was. It just involved gathering the required paperwork and then calling some people to get the bids that we needed and submitting everything. And like I said, Jessica was very good about walking us through each step of the process and really made it so simple. It was much easier than we expected it to be.
The homeowner's home that we're in right now, we replaced her windows and we got her a new AC unit for the summer.
We can already tell a big difference with the windows, and it's only been a few weeks, just in, like, on some of the windy days, not feeling the wind come through and not feeling the cold air, or the way the rooms are staying much warmer just from the new windows that are put in. And also the air conditioner unit, of course we haven't been able to benefit from that yet on these cooler days, but just with the heat blowing, we can tell an improvement in our heat as well, just with the new A coil being cleaner. And so we're looking forward to the energy savings that we're going to really notice as it gets warmer out. I would recommend it to anyone who qualifies for the program, because we were able to get things done that otherwise would have taken us a very long time to be able to save up the money to get, and it's really going to make a huge savings pretty quickly just in our utility bills. And so anyone that qualifies at all, I don't know why they wouldn't participate in the program.
I think this program is great because it helps out our O'Fallon residents who are struggling to even keep their homes right now. We can go in and we can help them save on their utility bills by replacing their windows or getting a new roof put on or helping out with electrical problems that can prevent fire. And I just think it's a great way for us to give back to our residents who are in need.
Don't be shy if you need help. The best way to get help is to go ahead and call Jessica Hawkins at 636-379-5411, or shoot her an email at jhawkins@ofallon.mo.us.
You can count on this dedicated group of volunteers to assist our first responders in the event of a natural disaster. Here's Brett Figgis with more on our CERT program.
The CERT program was started by the LA Fire Department back in 1994. CERT stands for Community Emergency Response Team.
CERT training promotes a partnering effort between emergency services and the people they serve.
It's an organization of community volunteers, civilians, and professionals that get together to assist in disaster and other types of emergencies.
The goal is for emergency personnel to train members of neighborhoods, community organizations, or workplaces in basic response skills.
It's important for the City of O'Fallon's Police Department to have a CERT program in case we have a large disaster, something that the emergency personnel may have a longer response to get to. It enables there to be individuals that are in the area that can help, can prepare, organize the area, if you will.
Emergency crews are not going to be able to get to everybody right away. So knowing yourself how to protect yourself, your family, even those around you, like your neighbors, can help the emergency response teams give them a little bit more time to get you to the help that you need.
CERT members maintain and refine their skills by participating in exercises and activities. They can attend supplemental training opportunities offered by the sponsoring agency and others that further their skill base. Finally, CERT members can volunteer for projects that improve community emergency preparedness.
CERT is an all-year program. They meet every second Tuesday of the month. They do training. I believe the same thing I'm learning now, I have to learn again in a few months, just so we stay knowledgeable of what's going on.
So what are the requirements for joining CERT?
Persons must be at least 18 years of age, be residents of St. Charles County, have no felony convictions or outstanding warrants.
You're just taking the course in order to be able to have additional information to assist you and your family. That's fine. If you've got the time and the resources and the ability to do more and help out the community, that's fine too. The dedication is strictly based on how much you have to give.
We're from CERT. We're here to check, and we're going to be bringing somebody by to help you out real quick, okay?
I expect to get the knowledge of how to put out a fire, how to use a fire extinguisher, how to do a light search and rescue, the prepper techniques of how to prepare for a disaster.
If you want to get more information on the CERT program, contact Officer Andrew Stowers. He's actually the CERT coordinator. He can be contacted at astowers@o'fallon.mo.us, or his direct line is area code 636-379-3816.
We'll come back for you before we leave.
This next program awards scholarships in exchange for commitment. Here's Joe Meyer with more.
It's important for our plants to go through photosynthesis in order to grow.
School districts across Missouri have reported difficulty recruiting and retaining teachers in several different areas.
Back in 2004, Deputy Superintendent Patty Corum formed a committee to study how the Fort Zumwalt School District could respond to the growing need for teachers certified in special education, foreign language, industrial technology, and high school math and science.
So as a committee, we studied the concept and we developed the program. And then at the end, we discovered now we need to have funding for that, which obviously it can't be paid for by taxpayers' dollars. So we incorporated a foundation in 2005 to fund the program. We became incorporated in November of 2005. Then we started the 501c3 process. So it took about a year once that board was formed to complete all the paperwork to be a 501c3. And then we started fundraising at that time.
Every spring, interested juniors attend a leadership program where they learn what it means to teach in high needs areas. Potential students then decide if they want to apply for the Grow Your Own Teachers program.
They have to apply by September 15th. I think this year we extended that to October 1st of their senior year. So in the fall of their senior year, we have taken one or two a year. And, you know, it depends. The students receive $3,000 a semester from the foundation to go to college and get certified. So that is $24,000 for one student. So the foundation needs to make sure they have the funds, because this is a promise on their part to fund these students. After they finish college, what we're doing is we're picking teachers before they even started college. So we're picking students at age 17 or 18 years old, so they really have to show potential and strength in that teacher capacity.
The Grow Your Own Teachers program is still in its early stages, but two local students are already reaping the benefits.
I would recommend the program because They're keeping you in check for making sure that you are on top of those applications, that you know what's required in an actual district. They want you to come back and teach for them, and that's a great thing to have a job lined up. They're going to make sure that you know what an effective teacher is and how you will be an effective teacher.
About what we're going to need for our research paper.
I would recommend it because it gives you a lot of personal contacts within the district. So many opportunities I've gotten I know I probably wouldn't have been able to have without being a Grow Your Own teacher. And also, it's another reason that it would be so great to be a part of it is because you know you're going to have that job. You get the scholarship money, which I know for some kids is such a big deal because college is getting expensive these days.
And I just want to continue to find the best teachers we can find. And some of those teachers have been graduates from Fort Zumwalt. So if we can capture those people early and then help them grow. You learn so much in college, but there's so much to talk about as you're processing, and we meet with these students twice a year and we talk about what they're learning and what they're confused about, and we just really help grow them. And that is so meaningful to me, that it's just a piece of getting the best teachers we can for our children in Fort Zumwalt School District. And I think this is an important part of it.
Coming back and people seeing that you can return to the community and work for it, you're going to be able to inspire those who are here. Whether it's high schoolers that I will be teaching or middle schoolers or whatever level it'll be, they'll be able to see that you can come back and give back to that community.
It's going to be so amazing. I've gone here through kindergarten to 12th grade, so I've done the full spectrum, and I've gained so much through it, my entire, education besides college, and just it's just a good way to repay the district because it's given me so much through learning and extracurricular activities, and I'm very excited to come back and be kind of pay the district back for those teachers that I had that were so amazing.
If you would like to help grow local teachers in our area, you can sign up for the 5K run and 1 mile fun run walk to benefit the Grow Your Own Teachers Educational Foundation. The race takes place on Saturday, May 12th at 8 a.m. at North High School.
It's time for a break. When we return, we'll check out a project that will have far-reaching benefits for our residents. We'll also see what it's like to step into the boots of an O'Fallon firefighter. Stay tuned to O'Fallon Matters.
The O'Fallon Theater Works Summer Theater Camp and Workshop is back. Starting July 9th, come check out our exciting 3-week theater programs, which will offer children and teens an opportunity to explore their natural creativity and build confidence through learning and using performing arts skills. Each participant will create an original character and then collaborate on a storyline and play. They'll focus on developing creative thinking skills, script writing, and character development, plus voice work, physical characterization, costuming, set design, and rehearsals, culminating in a matinee production for family and friends to enjoy on July 28th at 2 p.m. The camp is for actors ages 9 through 12 and will run Monday through Friday from 8 a.m. to 12 noon at the City Hall Auditorium. The workshop is for ages 13 through 17 and will run Monday through Friday from 1 to 5 p.m. at the City Hall Auditorium. The cost for this 3-week camp is $225 for residents and $249 for non-residents. Don't miss this incredible opportunity to inspire the budding actor in your child.
So, same time next week?
Well, of course.
Put away a few bucks, feel like a million bucks. For free tips to help you save, go to
Feed the Pig.
Welcome back to O'Fallon Matters. I recently had the chance to sit down with the O'Fallon Historical Society's archivist, Pat Swinger. Pat helped me realize how much history is right here in O'Fallon. Tell us about how you got involved in the Historical Society.
Okay, this had to be back in 2001 or two. The community news actually started a whole new section on Old Town. And the sales rep called on us, you know, for advertising sales. And in the course of the conversation, discovered that I'd been born and raised in O'Fallon. And, you know, by then we were in the minority already because the city had grown so much. Mm. So she encouraged me to write an article on Old Town, and I did. And over the next few years, one article turned into 50. And in the course of that, you know, I interviewed a lot of people, because I didn't start on this because I was any expert on O'Fallon history. In fact, it was quite the opposite. So I had a lot to learn. So I enjoyed interviewing people and hearing their stories and learning. And Cheryl Hibbler, a friend of ours, encouraged us to get involved in the Historical Society, and we did, which, you know, went into the sesquicentennial and all that gathering of information. So it's just been a natural progression. Probably in the process of working on the book that we put out for the sesquicentennial. Mm-hmm. That was the first step in really organizing, because I found out very quickly that not a lot of information had been accumulated on O'Fallon history, and what they did have, you know, no one had ever organized it in any respect. So that was the beginning of the process, the putting the book together. And then, you know, our dear friend Raleigh Jessup passed away, and his son, Kenny, came into our office one day with about six huge boxes full of stuff that was in Raleigh's basement. And we started by going through literally a mountain of newspapers, which is the worst medium for saving anything. Right. So we clipped articles and then we copied them and started a file. Then we
just took, be a paper file, just in a folder, and that's all you had.
A folder in a file cabinet, yeah. Right. And then the next step was to take somewhere between 500 and 600 documents. So we cleaned all of those by hand, and, you know, in keeping with archival procedures, and then encapsulated them. But we also then digitized everything and spreadsheeted it, labeled it, and all that. So our ultimate goal is to get all this stuff digitized so that it can be put into a searchable database.
Mm-hmm. And some of that history is no longer here, and there's right. stuff like Aunt Rosie's house, right down on Church Street. Isn't that a heartbreaker?
That's a Take a minute. You know, the day that house burned, I didn't think they'd be able to save it, but I was hoping and hoping and hoping. Mm-hmm. You know, and we're not one of those, you know, river towns with all the brick buildings that have survived, you know, 200-300 years. But to think that our history is just in our buildings would be foolish. Mm-hmm. Our history is in our stories. Mm-hmm. You know, Civic Hall is another great story. The proceeds from the centennial in 1956 were used to build station number one, fire station number one, which is on Elm Street. Of course, it originally didn't look as large, wasn't as large as it is now, and Civic Hall. They, like I said, there was no city staff at the time, so if they needed a street sign, or the streets needed oiled, or because most of them were, you know, a lot of them were still dirt roads, they just did it, whatever needed done. And I think that's what's so important about this, because we live in an age now where we've gotten more sophisticated, and that's good, but as a citizen, we rely on city staff and municipal services to build our town and take care of it for us. And I just think it's a wonderful thing for kids to realize that, you know, this town didn't just fall out of the sky somewhere. You know, it was built.
Even if some of our history is going away, some of it is coming back. We've got the fort.
Right.
And Zumwalt's Park that's coming along fabulously.
Yes, that's exciting to see. It is.
And that was one. That was one that was started by our good friend Raleigh Jessup. That was his.
That
baby.
Was his passion. That's why when you pull into Fort Zumwalt Park, the street sign says Jessup Drive.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. He wasn't the first to advocate for the rebuilding of the fort. That goes all the way back to Miss Marcia Williams. She was a member of the Daughters of the War of 1812, and they began advocating for the rebuilding of that fort in the 1920s. And it continued to fall down. And Raleigh, bless his heart, I know, you know, I'd just give anything if he was still here to see the progress, although he's watching it. He was right. He observed it's probably a good thing that we actually are getting this accomplished when we did in the order that we did, because the archaeological digs that we had done revealed so much information to us that potentially kept us from doing it not as accurately as we are now.
Okay, where do you think the O'Fallon's historical site is going from here?
Organization cycle. And one of the things I hope for is that I can get done what I want to get done so that they don't need me here anymore. You know, I mean, I want all of that stuff, all that information, all those photos thoroughly organized and accessible. There's always a new crop of people to come in, and I think, you know, hopefully as we get in the future, if we get Crickle House up and running, I think the historical aspect of town will be more visible again and maybe inspire more membership. In fact, I really get jazzed when somebody joins the Historical Society that's new to town, because I just think it's so wonderful that someone new would be so willing to embrace O'Fallon's history. To me, that's the best.
Did you ever wonder what O'Fallon firefighters were doing when they're not fighting fires? Joe Meyer decided to spend a day at station number 4 to get an idea.
The O'Fallon Fire Protection District's firefighters are always putting their lives on the line. They fight fires and they respond to general emergencies. So what do our firefighters do when they have downtime from those spur-of-the-moment emergencies?
Our shift starts at 7:30 in the morning. Generally, the first thing we do is go to our fire truck and start by checking out our SCBA tank.
This SCBA tank is working like it's supposed to, so now I'm going to shut the air off and bleed the air down. And whenever the needle gets to the red part, that's going to be the low air alarm is going to sound. So once this needle gets to the red,
generally once that's done, then we'll go and work out. Take about two hours with changing and cleaning up. The demand of fighting a fire is pretty high. With our gear and our tank and our helmet, it's almost 50 pounds of extra weight you're carrying. The work on a fire is very physically demanding, plus the environment, the heat just will wear your body out fast, so you have to be physically fit.
Besides staying fit, firefighters are always training.
Station 4 is where we keep our ladder truck. Station 4 is where we have both of our, we got the training trailer and then we got the training tower. So this is pretty much the training headquarters, I guess you would call it, for O'Fallon Fire District. As an engineer, you're pretty much responsible for the fire truck. Everything, the maintenance on it, making sure the pump is working proper, tire pressures are all accurate, so. You know, your main job is to get the guys to the call and back home from the call. And then after lunch, If whatever tools we did not check out on the truck, we'll normally get to those. And then after all of our equipment is checked out, there's house duties to do. We'll clean toilets, mop floors, stuff like that. And then usually once that's done, we'll do some sort of training exercise.
In the evening, our firefighters sit down to eat dinner just like us. Only they have to be on call all hours of the night.
It all goes back to training. You know, you go through your steps of how your tank's gonna work, what hose you're gonna pull, you know, what tool you're gonna use if you need to, you know, force entry. It's almost in a routine now that I've been here long enough.
I encourage any O'Fallon citizen to come up and do a ride along with us. You know, we can put you in the gear, we can put you in the tanks, we'll let you ride the fire truck. So we do have a ride along program. I don't know, a lot of people don't know about our ride along program. And we do have a volunteer service too.
Walking and biking are getting easier in O'Fallon. Here's Kim Doan with the scoop.
Over the past several years, there's been an increased interest in cycling and walking in O'Fallon, Wentzville, and Lake St. Louis, as well as the St. Louis region, where more individuals are seen walking and using bicycles for not only recreation purposes, but also for fitness and transportation. In 2007, a planning process began for a bikeable walkable study that would include O'Fallon, Lake St. Louis, and Wentzville.
Walkable Bikeable Plan was developed back in 2008. We received a grant from TrailMet, and it was not only to take a look at O'Fallon and our modes of transportation throughout the city, but also how we might connect with Wentzville and Lake St. Louis. So it was looking at how do we expand transportation from being just motorized vehicles. So looking at all of our roads and corridors to establish bike paths, pedestrian paths, and alternate means of transportation throughout the city. Findings for the study showed that the city had a start on how to connect the city through bike paths and pedestrian paths, but we have a long way to go. We have a lot of, use Highway K as an example. We have a lot of areas that start and then they stop. So we have a lot of pieces to fill in. Obviously we have a good sidewalk system throughout the city, but the major corridors, your Highway K, Bryan Road, Fizey, those type roads, that's where we needed to look. So we've developed a plan that can connect the entire city with bike paths and pedestrian paths. Eventually, we'd like to connect with the Darden corridor, the greenway that's going along the Darden, which will eventually tie into the Katy Trail. So as all these plans continue to get developed, it will really connect not only O'Fallon, but O'Fallon to St. Charles County and even into St. Louis County. This plan is, there's short-term components that we can work on, and then there's long-term components. And so it's gonna be a living plan. It's gonna continue to grow, and we'll just develop it as opportunities become available. It's important to have trails and paths to encourage our residents to get out and be physically active, as well as reduce the carbon footprint of all the vehicles throughout the community as well.
Overseeing the construction of new bike paths in the city is the responsibility of the Public Works Department. Here to discuss projects is Wade Montgomery, the city engineer.
The city has some upcoming exciting projects regarding our bike and trail system. One project we just finished was resurfacing Bryan Road from Highway N up to 70, as well as resurfacing the trail along Mexico Road from Bryan to K. The project that we're getting ready to construct this year is the Fizey Road Trail Extension Project, which involves constructing a new asphalt trail from Highway K over to Bryan Road. And another trail project that we're completing plans on, we'll be bidding out this year, is a 10-mile loop project that involves restriping existing shoulders to allow for bike trails. That project will start at Highway K and Page 360 South Outer Road. It will go down Highway K to Technology Drive, continue along Technology Drive and then up Winghaven Boulevard, and then back along Page Outer Road to tie back into K. It's basically a 10-mile loop around the south part of the city, allow bicyclists the ability to drive and access areas using alternate means. Project that we just completed was West Terra. We resurfaced the roadway from North Central over to Hoff Road, and we also widened the shoulders to again allow, and we striped it to allow for bicyclists to utilize. We'll continue that project from Hoff Road over to Guthrie Road in 2013. We're acquiring right-of-way right now, and we'll bid that project out later in the year, and then funds will be available in 2013 to continue that project. Future plans have to continue it also to the east from North Central over to Highway K, so basically to provide ultimately a widened shoulder to allow bicyclists to use from Guthrie Road over to Highway M. The city continues to look for grant opportunities and outside funding sources that allow us to continue to improve and expand our bike and pedestrian systems. Additionally, you can always go to our website and find information regarding these projects and all other projects on the city's website under City Projects.
We hope you enjoyed our show. O'Fallon Matters airs right here on O'Fallon TV every month. So remember to give back to your community, because O'Fallon matters to all of us.